intolerance that develops during the course of pregnancy, that is the original gestational diabetes mellitus, or the diabetes that was present prior to pregnancy but it is being diagnosed during pregnancy, we call this type of diabetes as overt or pre-existing diabetes mellitus. But as it is being diagnosed during pregnancy, so we keep this under the definition of gestational diabetes mellitus. So the glucose intolerance that either develops during the course of pregnancy or it is being diagnosed during pregnancy, both are under same heading, the gestational diabetes mellitus. So the important aspects of gestational diabetes mellitus, if we consider from your examination point of view, we can give you a pre-pregnancy counseling session station in which you can you have to counsel the patient who is already diagnosed in case of diabetes, and she wants to embark on pregnancy. So one station could be like this. The second station we can give you, like if the patient has got her gestational diabetes mellitus test done, like OGTT at 28 weeks of gestation, and that test is deranged, so you have to diagnose whether this is gestational diabetes or not, and what you are going to counsel her regarding her management. And the third station could be like general dietary advice or from management point of view as well. So pre-pregnancy counseling is very important, and the aim of this pre-pregnancy counseling would be to achieve the best possible glycemic control before pregnancy, because once she gets pregnant, the organogenesis period is very important. If she is having hyperglycemia during that organogenesis time period, there would be increased chances of development of congenital malformations. So the prime aim is to achieve the best possible glycemic control prior to pregnancy. And we have to educate the diabetic women about the implications of pregnancy, and if she is already on some type of medications like ACE inhibitors that are not compatible with pregnancy, or statins, so we have to change those medications. But if you get a station in your examination regarding pre-pregnancy counseling, so here are all points that you have to cover. So first of all would be glycosylated hemoglobin. If the glycosylated hemoglobin is well controlled, yes, she can get pregnant. But if the glycosylated hemoglobin is uncontrolled, please counsel her against pregnancy and give her some contraceptive advice that she cannot embark on pregnancy with this much high glycemic control, because there would be increased chances of development of congenital malformation in her. So optimization of glycemic control is very important. The second important thing that we have already discussed is that we have to modify her medications. If she's on statins or some kind of antihypertensives that are not safe in pregnancy, so we have to change that. And in diabetes, we have to give high dose folic acid, means 5 milligrams of folic acid right from the start of pregnancy to combat the risk of congenital malformations. Okay, we have already discussed that if the glycosylated hemoglobin is uncontrolled, then we have to start her on adequate contraception. If the patient is already diabetic, so we have to screen for the diabetic complication in collaboration with the diabetologist and medical unit. So what are those diabetic complications? Retinopathy, nephropathy, or neuropathy, or macrovascular complications as well. Because during the course of pregnancy, if you see the last two points on this slide, the deterioration of pre-existing retinopathy can occur during the course of pregnancy, or the deterioration of established nephropathy can also happen during her pregnancy. So we have to screen her for the diabetic complications. She should be given information about the optimal weight gain during her pregnancy, and she should be counseled regarding the risks to herself and the risk to her fetus due to diabetes. And she should also be told that she would experience more nausea and vomiting. She can, or she is likely to experience more nausea and vomiting in pregnancy, because as she is diabetic, so neuropathy ke effect ke under gastroparesis hota hai. And due to that gastroparesis, nausea and vomiting, vomitings are more likely in diabetic pregnancy. So we have already discussed the great importance of tight glucose control, not during or not in the pre-pregnancy time only, but during the course of pregnancy. Why? Pre-pregnancy, we have discussed that there is increased risk of congenital malformation. Once she become pregnant, there are chances of miscarriages, because hyperglycemia ki wajah se jo implantation hoti hai wo hamper ho jati hai, to miscarriages ke chances increase ho jate hain, stillbirths, polyhydramnios, macrosomia, preterm labor. So there are many risk factors that can develop if the glucose control is not optimal. Okay, if she is already on insulin, or if we have started her on insulin, the insulin requirements would increase with advancing gestation because of the pregnancy effects. And as well as there are more chances of severe hypoglycemia as well. And I want to emphasize this point, that hypoglycemia is far more dangerous as compared to hyperglycemia. Hyperglycemia is also dangerous, as I have already mentioned, multiple risks to the fetus and mother apart from those risk factors. We also can say that diabetic ketoacidosis can develop in mother, but hypoglycemia can cause sudden death. So we have to manage and we have to control her sugar levels in such a way that she does not develop hypoglycemia. But in pregnancy, she is more likely to develop hypoglycemia. So we have to be very vigilant. And we have already discussed that retinopathy and nephropathy tends to deteriorate with the course of pregnancy. So these are the points that you have to cover in the pre-pregnancy counseling OSCE station. Okay, what are the maternal complications of type 1 and type 2 diabetes? We are talking about overt or pre-existing diabetes mellitus. So preeclampsia is more common, three-fold increase in the preeclampsia risk. So we have to start her on aspirin tablet 75 milligrams right from the end of first trimester. Diabetic retinopathy, as it tends to increase and deteriorate during the course of pregnancy, so we have to screen her again and again. Once we have screened her in the pre-pregnancy time, now at booking, then at 16 weeks and 28 weeks, we have to screen her again and again. Severe hypoglycemia can develop, hyperglycemia can develop. There are more chances of infections, urinary tract infections, wound infections, and due to those infections, she is prone to develop preterm labor as well. And we have already discussed that diabetic ketoacidosis can also develop secondary to diabetes poor control. Fetal complications ki agar hum baat karte hain, to fetal macrosomia, congenital malformations, stillbirth, preterm delivery, increased risk of miscarriage, and increased operative delivery rate. We have already discussed this previously. So if we talk about management, so we have to involve medical specialist or diabetologist to optimize glycemic control in the patient. So we have to advise her vigorous monitoring of blood glucose 7 times a day, before breakfast, after breakfast, before lunch, after lunch, before dinner and after dinner, and at bedtime. So these are the 7 blood glucose levels that we will be achieving in this patient when once we have admitted her in our ward. So if the sugar levels are very deranged, that require insulin most probably, but if they are mildly deranged, we can start her on oral hypoglycemic agents like metformin or glibenclamide can also be given after first trimester. So she should be given dietary advice that she has to take food that doesn't contain sugar, though she can eat one fruit per day, but the fruit should not be very juicy and sugary. So dietary advice mein hum unko advice karte hain ki they have to take 3 meals and 3 snacks, and they have to take small portions to avoid sudden hyperglycemia, as well as they have to take a cup of milk before going to bed to avoid hypoglycemia during sleep. So we have to advise her on slight exercise, like she has to do a walk 15 minutes after every meal for 20 to 25 minutes. Okay, agar hum unko walk advice kar rahe hain after meals, so this is going to affect her post meal levels. In pregnancy, the post meal levels are more important, and we control post meal levels more vigorously, because post meal levels, they correlate with the development of macrosomia. Though we also control pre meal levels, but post meal levels are more important. And we also have to manage the patient, and we have to counsel her regarding hypoglycemia if she is feeling, because the symptoms of hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia are more or less same. So if she is experiencing palpitations, tremors and sweating, so she has to get her blood sugar done, and if it comes out to be less than 60 milligrams per deciliter, she has to take some type of food, a sandwich, a juice, a toffee, or something like this. So we have to counsel her for the risk of hypoglycemia as well and how to manage it. So we have already done the renal and retinal screening, and the fetal surveillance is very important. At 19 to 20 weeks of gestation, we have to get her fetal anomaly scan done to see the congenital malformations. So four chamber cardiac view and cardiac outflow tracts should be examined thoroughly during that fetal anomaly scan. And apart from this scan, we have to get serial growth scans 4 weekly or 3 weekly to assess fetal growth, macrosomia and polyhydramnios. Fetal growth serial scans pe hum dekh rahe hote hain, and abdominal circumference is the pinpoint thing that we have to see in those scans, and we have to look for fetal macrosomia. Whenever we have to assess for fetal growth, abdominal circumference is the parameter that we have to look for. So in fetal surveillance, fetal anomaly scan and serial growth scans to look for macrosomia and polyhydramnios. And we have to have a definite plan of delivery because of the risk of late stillbirth. We have to counsel the patient that we want her to deliver by 38 to 39 weeks. So we have to either induce the patient, or depending upon her past obstetric history, we have to get her cesarean section. So if we are planning delivery, we have to give antenatal corticosteroids depending upon the need. And as we all know that steroids, that they lead to hyperglycemia, so we have to adjust insulin dose accordingly. And we have discussed the timing and mode of delivery already. There are increased chances of cesarean section due to macrosomia, preeclampsia, failed induction of labor. Patients are more obese. If diabetic patients are more obese, so dysfunctional labor tends to settle in. So there are increased chances of cesarean section, and cesarean section rates are reported to be as high as 50%. During labor, the sliding scale of insulin and glucose monitoring should be commenced. So what is the aim of blood glucose level? The aim is 4 to 7 millimole to reduce the risk of neonatal hypoglycemia. So this is the level that we want prior to pregnancy and during labor. 4 to 7 millimoles. Prior to pregnancy bhi inka itna hi hona chahiye, during labor bhi itna hona chahiye, taki hum jo hai na risks ko avoid kar saken. Post deliveries jo hai, after delivery, insulin requirement return to pre-pregnancy levels. So insulin doses should be adjusted and reduced accordingly. Women should be informed of the increased risk of hypoglycemia in the postnatal period because they are breastfeeding as well, and insulin requirements have been decreased. Increased risk of type 2 diabetes mellitus later in life if the patient is typically with gestational diabetes mellitus who has developed glucose intolerance during the course of pregnancy. So there would be chances of type 2 diabetes mellitus development in later life. Okay, up till now we have discussed about type 1 or type 2 diabetes in pregnancy. It was gestational diabetes mellitus, but it was pre-existing, but we have diagnosed it during the course of pregnancy. Now what about a patient who enters the pregnancy while she is normal glycemic and we screen her for diabetes mellitus because we are Asians and we are at high risk for development of gestational diabetes mellitus. So I want to emphasize on this point that screening is done on healthy population. So screening can be universal screening or high risk group targeted. So a screening test can be a fasting blood sugar test or oral glucose tolerance test, oral glucose tolerance test, fasting blood sugar or glucose challenge test that has to be confirmed with oral glucose tolerance test. So if we want to screen her, we can have a single test approach, OGTT, or double test approach, first glucose challenge test and then embarking on oral glucose tolerance test. So now please make this point very clear that if the patient is already diabetic, if her blood sugar levels are already deranged, say I order a fasting blood sugar in a patient and it comes out to be 120 milligrams per deciliter, to uske pehle hi blood sugar levels deranged hain, we do not want ki usko hum 75 grams ka glucose load de dein. This is not on. हम स्क्रीनिंग उसी में करवा रहे हैं जो पहले डायबिटिक नहीं है, एंड वी वांट टू जस्ट नो कि ये अब डायबिटिक तो नहीं होगी. ठीक है, तो स्क्रीनिंग इज डन ऑन हेल्दी पॉपुलेशन, नंबर वन. नंबर टू, इफ इन ओरल ग्लूकोज टॉलरेंस टेस्ट, वी नो कि उसमें हम एक फास्टिंग लेवल करवाते हैं, उसके बाद वन आवर करवाते हैं, एंड टू आफ्टर टू आवर्स ऑफ 75 ग्राम्स ओरल ग्लूकोज लोड देते हैं. तो अगर उसका फास्टिंग ब्लड शुगर ही ज़्यादा आ जाता है तो हम उसको 75 ग्राम्स का लोड नहीं देते हैं. अगर उसका फास्टिंग नॉर्मल आता है उसके बाद उसको 75 ग्राम्स का ओरल लोड दिया जाता है, एंड देन वी हैव टू चेक द शुगर एट वन आवर ऑफ दैट लोड एंड आफ्टर टू आवर्स ऑफ दैट लोड. सो इफ वन लेवल कम्स आउट टू बी डिरेंज्ड इन दिस स्क्रीनिंग टेस्ट, इट वी डायग्नोज द पेशेंट एज विद gestation diabetes. So if we talk about whether we have to do the universal screening or high risk group screening, here As we are from ethnic group with high rates of type 2 diabetes, we are Asians, so we have to go for universal screening. Because we are already forming a high risk group in relation to our being Asian. So maternal obesity, if the patient is obese, or if there is prior history of large gestational age infant, macrosomic baby usne deliver kiya tha, yeah, there is family history of type 1 or type 2 diabetes, or she is from ethnic group with high rates of gestation diabetes, mellitus type 2, तो ये रिस्क फैक्टर्स हैं जिसमें आपने स्क्रीनिंग हाई रिस्क ग्रुप के अकॉर्डिंगली करनी है. इन जेपीएमसी वी आर डूइंग हाई रिस्क टारगेटेड स्क्रीनिंग, बट प्लीज नोट दैट वी आर फ्रॉम द एथनिक ग्रुप विद हाई रेट्स ऑफ डायबिटीज टाइप टू बिकॉज वी आर एशियन एंड वी हैव अ हाई हिस्ट्री फैमिली हिस्ट्री ऑफ टाइप टू डायबिटीज. Otherwise, if we want to go for high-risk group targeted screening, if the mother is obese or she had previously delivered a baby who was macrosomic, or family history related or ethnic group related, these are the risk factors which we have to see in this history, and then we have to go for screening. Okay. So these are the two screening tests criteria. If we talk about oral glucose tolerance test, NICE criteria and WHO guidelines, as both of these are mentioned in your book, so I had to add this in your topic. NICE criteria says that if the fasting blood sugars are more than 5.6 millimoles, or 2 hour post 75 load is more than 7.8, if even one reading is deranged, we will label the patient as with gestation diabetes. So you have to remember 5, 6, 7, 8. 5, 6, 7, 8. Fasting 5.6, 2 hours post load 7.8. 5, 6, 7, 8 for that. WHO guidelines jo thodi purani hai, they say 5, 10, and 8.5. 5, 10, and 8.5. So for NICE criteria, you have to remember 5, 6, 7, 8. And for WHO guidelines, you have to memorize 5, 10, and 8.5. Fasting 5.1, 1 hour more than 10, 2 hour more than 8.5 millimoles. इनमें से एक लेवल भी deranged आता है, तो पेशेंट को हम डायग्नोज कर देते हैं as with gestation diabetes mellitus. फिर हम उसको 2 weeks का ट्रायल देते हैं कि वो ब्लड शुगर मॉनिटरिंग करेगी, डाइट मॉडिफिकेशन करेंगे उसकी, हम थोड़ा सा उसको वॉक के लिए कैंसिल कर देंगे, एंड हम उसको बोलेंगे कि ब्लड ग्लूकोज मॉनिटरिंग करें ड्यूरिंग दोज टू वीक्स पीरियड दैट वी हैव गिवन हर. अगर उसमें उसके लेवल्स नॉर्मल रहते हैं, तो वी विल नॉट स्टार्ट एनी हाइपोग्लाइसेमिक एजेंट, बट इफ द लेवल्स आर डीरेंज ड्यूरिंग दिस टू वीक पीरियड, देन वी हैव टू स्टार्ट हर फर्स्ट ऑन ओरल हाइपोग्लाइसेमिक एजेंट, एंड इफ द लेवल्स आर स्टिल अनकंट्रोल्ड, देन वी हैव टू स्टार्ट हर ऑन add insulin in addition to her oral hypoglycemic agent. Okay, now going on the previous slide again. What are the targets of blood sugar control? जो अभी हमने बात की, WHO की बात की, और हमने NICE क्राइटेरिया की बात की, वो OGTT के लिए था, वो स्क्रीनिंग टेस्ट के लिए था, वो डायग्नोस करने के लिए था. अब जो हम बात कर रहे हैं, वो हम कर रहे हैं कि अब पेशेंट आपने डायग्नोस कर ली अकॉर्डिंग टू आइदर NICE क्राइटेरिया और WHO क्राइटेरिया, आपने डायग्नोस कर ली है कि वो डायबिटीज़ है, और आपने उसको 2 वीक्स का टाइम दिया है कि जी आप इसमें ब्लड ग्लूकोज मॉनिटरिंग करके आएँ और वॉक करें और डाइटरी मॉडिफिकेशन करें, तो उन 2 वीक्स में इसका टारगेट कैपिलरी ग्लूकोज लेवल क्या होना चाहिए. मैंने आपको 5, 6, 7, 8 कहा था, उसको थोड़ा सा मॉडिफाइड कर दें, 5, 3, 7, 8 याद कर लें. प्री मील उसका 95 मिलीग्राम्स होना चाहिए, 5.3 होना चाहिए, एंड 1 आवर पोस्ट मील उसका 7.8 होना चाहिए. इसको आप ऐसे भी मॉडिफाई कर सकते हैं के प्री मील लेस देन 100, 1 आवर 140 एंड 2 आवर 120, 100, 140, 120, ठीक है जी। इसके टारगेट कैपिलरी ग्लूकोज लेवल होने चाहिए ऐसे पेशेंट के जो कि ऑलरेडी डायग्नोज हो चुकी है एज विद गेस्टेशन डायबिटीज मेलिटस। सो वी हैव टॉक्ड ऑलरेडी अबाउट नाइस क्राइटेरिया एंड WHO गाइडलाइंस। दिस ऑल्सो शोज दैट द स्क्रीनिंग शुड बी यूनिवर्सल और हाई रिस्क टारगेटेड और इट शुड बी वन स्टेप ओनली इंक्लूडिंग 75 ग्राम्स ओरल ग्लूकोज टॉलरेंस और first you have to go, get her glucose challenge test followed by OGTT. So I think that we should not go in this detail. Okay, now GDM management. जो मैंने आपको पहले ही बता दिया है कि जो glucose intolerance develop हो रहा है during the course of pregnancy उसकी management थोड़ी सी अलग है। जो type 1 और type 2 डायबिटिक्स हैं जिनकी शुगर लेवल्स बहुत ज़्यादा आएंगी जब आप उनको मॉनिटर करेंगे तो आपको सब पता चल जाएगा कि वो प्री एग्जिस्टिंग डायबिटीज़ थे और फर्स्ट ट्रेमेस्टर से ही वो डायबिटिक चलते हुए आ रहे हैं। गेस्टेशन डायबिटीज मेलिटस जो होगी वो रिलेटिवली ज़रा लेट डिवेलप होगी, रिलेटिवली माइल्डर होगी, तो इस तरह हमें पता चल जाएगा। और उसको हमने खुद ही डायग्नोज किया होगा आइदर थ्रू फास्टिंग ब्लड शुगर्स और OGTT और इसकी इम्प्लीकेशंस और रिस्क फैक्टर्स काफ़ी कम होंगे गेस्टेशन डायबिटीज मेलिटस जो कि डिवेलप हुई है ड्यूरिंग द कोर्स ऑफ प्रेगनेंसी, क्योंकि ऑर्गेनोजेनेसिस में द पेशेंट वाज नॉर्मल ग्लाइसेमिक, सो द रिस्क ऑफ कॉन्जेनिटल मैलफॉर्मेशंस आर लेस, रिस्क ऑफ मिसकैरेजेस आर लेस, एंड एज द ग्लूकोज इंटॉलरेंस दैट डिवेलप्स ड्यूरिंग द कोर्स ऑफ प्रेगनेंसी इज टेंड्स टू बी माइल्डर। So the risk of development of macrosomia, polyhydramnios, neos, preterm labor, all these risks are far less as compared to the patients who already have diabetes mellitus. So in GDM management, we have discussed that we have to give lifestyle modification, diet and exercise for 2 weeks. And if during those 2 weeks, her blood sugar levels are not within range that we had discussed 5.3 and 7.8 millimoles. तो फिर हम उनको oral hypoglycemic start करेंगे, metformin या glibenclamide, and if the blood sugar levels are still uncontrolled, we can add insulin regimens. And after the delivery of a patient who had gestational diabetes, we have to screen out type 2 diabetes at 6 to 13 weeks. After the birth of baby, 6 to 13 weeks पे हमने उसका एक फास्टिंग ब्लड शुगर करवाना है या ग्लाइकोसाइलेटेड हीमोग्लोबिन करवाना है, क्योंकि ये पेशेंट्स दे आर मोर प्रोन टू डिवेलप टाइप 2 डायबिटीज लेटर इन लाइफ। ओके, वन मोर पॉइंट दैट आई वॉन्ट टू क्लियर, इफ यू वॉन्ट टू कन्वर्ट मिली मोल्स इन टू मिलीग्राम्स पर डेसिलीटर, यू हैव टू मल्टीप्लाई मिली मोल्स फिगर विद 18। मतलब अगर 5.3 है, मल्टीप्लाई इट विद 18, यू विल गेट 95 मिलीग्राम्स पर डेसिलीटर। सो व्हेन एवर यू हैव टू चेंज मिलीमोल्स इन मिलीग्राम्स, यू हैव टू मल्टीप्लाई द नंबर विद 18। आपको दोनों लेवल्स याद होने चाहिए। गेस्टेशन डायबिटीज मेलिटस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड वेरी बेसिक, तो प्लीज़ आपको मिलीमोल्स में भी याद होना चाहिए, आपको मिलीग्राम्स में भी याद होना चाहिए इफ यू टॉक अबाउट योर एग्जामिनेशन। सेकेंड पॉइंट, आपको थोड़ा सा आइडिया होना चाहिए इंसुलिन रेजिमेंस के बारे में। इंसुलिन रेजिमेंस, हम बहुत लॉन्ग एक्टिंग इंसुलिन नहीं यूज़ करते ड्यूरिंग प्रेगनेंसी, वी जस्ट यूज़ रेगुलर इंसुलिन एंड NPH इंसुलिन, क्योंकि जो लॉन्ग एक्टिंग इंसुलिन होती हैं दे कैन कॉज hypoglycemia, and as hypoglycemia chances are already much more in pregnancy, so we tend to avoid long acting insulin regimens during pregnancy. दूसरी बात, very short acting भी use नहीं करते हम, very rapid भी नहीं use करते, we use regular insulin. So when we start the patient on insulin, we start her on basal bolus regimen. Basal bolus regimen क्या है कि NPH जो है वो हम या सिर्फ एक टाइम दे रहे हैं रात के टाइम या दो टाइम दे रहे हैं, before breakfast as well as before dinner दो टाइम NPH देने का दे के बेसल कंट्रोल अचीव कर रहे हैं एंड बोलस मीन्स रेगुलर आप दे रहे हैं बोलस विद ईच मील सो थ्री रेगुलर डोजेस अ डे एंड वन और टू NPH doses per day are used to control blood sugar levels in patients with gestational diabetes. इसमें थोड़ा सा जो है कॉन्सेप्ट ये होता है कि जो रेगुलर इंसुलिन होती है वो कंट्रोल करती है आपकी पोस्ट मील लेवल्स और जो NPH है वो प्री मील लेवल्स पे ज़्यादा इफेक्ट होता है उसका तो हमें जो है ना थोड़ा सा जब डोज मॉडिफिकेशन करते हैं हम इंसुलिन की डोज इंक्रीज या डिक्रीज करते हैं तो हमें ये एक आइडिया होना चाहिए NPH इंसुलिन का पोस्ट मील पे भी इफेक्ट है बट इट हैज़ मोर इफेक्ट ऑन प्री मील लेवल्स सेकेंडली एक और फिनोमेना होता है डॉन्स फिनोमेना एंड सोमोगाइव फिनोमेना उसमें ये होता है कि जब भी आपको इंसुलिन की डोजेस एडजस्ट करनी हो तो आपको पता होना चाहिए स्पेशली अगर फास्टिंग ब्लड शुगर बहुत ज़्यादा है तो वो डॉन्स फिनोमेना के अंडर इफेक्ट भी ज़्यादा हो सकती है और वो सोमोगाय के फिनोमेना के अंडर इफेक्ट भी ज़्यादा हो सकती है डॉन्स में क्या सोमोगाय में क्या होता है कि रात में पेशेंट को हाइपोग्लाइसीमिया होता है और उस हाइपोग्लाइसीमिया की वजह से रिएक्शनरी हार्मोन स्टीरॉइड्स वगैरह रिलीज़ होते हैं एंड सुबह में जब हम शुगर चेक करते हैं तो वो हाइपोग्लाइसीमिया मिलती है और जो डॉन्स फिनोमेना होता है उसमें रात से हाइपरग्लाइसीमिया चलता 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 सुबह तक आ रहा होता है तो प्लीज़ बी रिमाइंडेड कि इनकी ट्रीटमेंट डिफरेंट है इनकी अगर सोमोगाय है तो वी हैव टू रिड्यूस NPH डोज ऑफ नाइट टाइम ताकि उसको रात में हाइपोग्लाइसीमिया हो और फिर रिएक्टिव हाइपरग्लाइसीमिया इन द मॉर्निंग ना हो और अगर डॉन्स फिनोमेना है तो वी हैव टू इंक्रीज नाइट टाइम NPH सो दैट हर हाइपरग्लाइसीमिया is controlled to such an effect ke to such an extent ke uska morning ka level bhi behtar ho if you have any queries please contact me on my WhatsApp 0331216927 thank you